Hi, let's talk about the diaphragm. In this video, I'll describe the basic structure of the diaphragm and identify its neurovascular supply. So the diaphragm is a musculofibrous sheet that's going to separate the thoracic cavity from the abdominopelvic cavity. That musculofibrous sheet has a bimodal dome shape to it. So on the donor right side, that consists of the most robust right cupula, separated from the less robust left cupula. And the two cupulae, are separated by the central tendon. That central tendon has a very close physical relationship. In fact, it's bonded to the fibrous pericardium. Now, if we think about the relationship of the abdominal pelvic viscera, that kind of helps to understand the shape of the diaphragm. And we'll get to these organs in the GI sessions. But deep to the right cupula, we have the right lobe of the liver, which is very robust, as well as the right kidney in there and suprarenal gland. Those are more associated with the posterior aspect of the diaphragm rather than the cupula itself. Deep to the left cupula, we can see a little bit of it here. We have the left lobe of the diaphragm. We also have the fundus of the stomach. So we'll have, you can see the esophagus going in there. The fundus of the stomach is right there. We'll also have adjacent to that the spleen and the left kidney and suprarenal gland in that vicinity. So the diaphragm itself is the major muscle of respiration. So it contracting is going to increase the volume of the thoracic cavity, thereby decreasing pressure, thereby allowing air to flow into the lungs. And it's able to do so because its attachment is all along the thoracic outlet. The thoracic inlet is that space between the first ribs and the manubrium and the first thoracic vertebrae. And the thoracic outlet is that space lining the division between thoracic and abdominal pelvic cavities. So that includes the costal margin here and the lateral margins of ribs 11 and 12, as well as the crura of the diaphragm, which extend down to the third lumbar vertebra, as we'll see. Now, this is a view of the inferior surface of the diaphragm. This would be the surface that is in contact with the abdominal pelvic cavity. And we can see that there are 1, 2, 3 apertures through the diaphragm that are going to conduct some very important neurovasculature. So the first aperture that I'd like us to discuss is the caval opening. That caval opening is the space through which the inferior vena cava is going to pass on its way up into the right atrium of the heart. Also through this aperture is going to be a branch of the right phrenic nerve and some lymphatics. This caval opening is the highest of the three apertures at T8. Left lateral and a little posterior to the caval opening is the esophageal hiatus. The esophageal hiatus is the space through which the esophagus is transmitted. Also in association with the esophagus are going to be the vagal trunks, both anterior and posterior. An esophageal branch of the left gastric artery is going to ascend because that's a branch of the celiac trunk up through that esophageal hiatus to follow the esophagus. And there will also be some lymphatics. Now keep in mind, those vagal trunks are going to be innervating the gut tube. So it's a good thing that they're traveling along with the esophagus. The esophageal hiatus is two vertebral levels down at T10. And then finally, we have the aortic hiatus. The aortic hiatus is less of an aperture through, more of an aperture behind the diaphragm. So if we were to actually pay attention to what's going on here, here is the posterior margin of the diaphragm, and we have a left crus and a right crus here, and the margins of these crura come down to L3, and there's this nice teardrop space through which the aorta can transition between thoracic and abdominal parts. Now, along with that descending aorta, we're going to have the thoracic duct ascending through that space. We'll also have a branch of the azygos system ascending through that space as well. And it's important to note that the thoracic splanchnic nerves will be transmitted in this vicinity, but they don't travel through the aortic hiatus. They are going to pierce through the left and right crura themselves. And then finally, the sympathetic trunks are also going to travel posterior to the diaphragm as well, just lateral to the crura on the... They'll share a nice lateral relationship to the vertebral bodies, as we'll see. So that aortic hiatus is at T12. So caval at 8, esophageal at 10, and aortic at 12. In terms of the neurovasculature, we should think about both the superior and inferior surface of the diaphragm. The nerves that innervate the diaphragm, or that innervate each hemidiaphragm, are the phrenic nerves. The phrenic nerves are predominantly branches of the cervical plexus. The cervical plexus is a somatic plexus consisting of ventral primary rami of the first through the fourth cervical nerves. There's also a tiny contribution from C5. C5 comes from the brachial plexus. The brachial plexus consists of contributions of ventral primary rami of C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1. So you can see how the phrenic nerve is going to span both of those plexuses. The bulk of fibers are coming from C4, so that roots this pretty solidly within the cervical plexus. So the mnemonic here to remember is C3-4-5 keeps the diaphragm alive, and each phrenic nerve innervates a hemidiaphragm. So they're going to predominantly drive respiration. Now, in terms of arterial supply, the dominant arterial supply is going to come from inferior to the diaphragm, but there are three arteries that will supply the diaphragm superiorly. The main arteries are going to be the superior phrenic arteries, and these are direct branches of the abdominal, the thoracic part of the descending aorta. Also, pericardiacophrenic arteries, these are branches of internal thoracic artery that are going to accompany the phrenic nerves on the way down. And there will also be branches, while we're talking about internal thoracic, of the musculophrenic arteries. The musculophrenic arteries are those terminal branches of the internal thoracic artery. So the superior epigastric artery divides from the musculophrenic artery. And that musculophrenic artery, as its name suggests, will supply some blood to the superior surface of the diaphragm. Now, draining the superior surface of the diaphragm are the pericardiacophrenic veins and the musculophrenic veins. Those are going to drain into the internal thoracic veins. Posteriorly, there may be a little bit of drainage through the azygos system. Minor contributions. And then the inferior surface supplies the bulk of the blood to the diaphragm via the inferior phrenic arteries. These inferior phrenic arteries supply the diaphragm inferiorly. And then in terms of veins, there's a bit of an asymmetry here. On the left side, the left inferior phrenic vein typically goes down and drains into the left renal vein, as we'll see in that session. Whereas on the right side, the right inferior phrenic vein drains into the inferior vena cava. That left renal vein eventually drains into the inferior vena cava. So all roads lead to Rome, or in this case, the inferior vena cava, to conduct the blood back up to the right atrium of the heart. So we've discussed the structure of the diaphragm and its various apertures. So the caval opening, the esophageal hiatus, as well as the aortic hiatus and their contents. We've discussed the various neurovascular supply of the diaphragm, including the phrenic nerves and the inferior phrenic arteries, among other vessels. This is your summary slide. Thank you very much for your time.